Hi snooker fans, Emma Mafflin and Curtis Braithwaite here for daffersnooker.com. Welcome to the first episode of Breakfast with the Boys, where throughout the season we will be catching up with players on the tour to discuss all things snooker and much more. Today we have with us the colourful character Alan Taylor, the man known as the MOD, Martin O'Donnell, and lastly the man known as the Storm, although we like to call him the Light Breeze, Sean O'Sullivan.
Is that right?
How are you, lads?
Very well, thanks.
Very good.
All good?
Very good.
Yeah, please help yourself.
Trust you, go straight for a cookie.
That's about right for the store, but he doesn't mind a cookie. Cookie in the gym, nice balance up.
I'm surprised you haven't pre-ordered the steak and chips.
But my boys, just before we start, are you guys happy with the spread? Because I know you guys are very fussy with...
Listen, I'm going in.
Very fussy, how dare you?
I'm really fussy.
What if you don't need to be fussy with the food? I'm about ironing out this croissant in a minute.
Just make sure you save some for us, yeah? Because we've not eaten yet.
No, we've not. We put you guys first.
You look like you haven't eaten as well.
I'm wasting away here, mate. You know what I mean? I'm wasting away, mate. Do you know what I mean?
Right, shall we get cracking?
Yes, Nada, we'll get cracking.
So, with the first tournament out of the way, how are you feeling about the start of the season? Alan, if I could come to you first.
Take blind date, isn't it? Fantastic number one. Well, yeah, I'm pretty pleased. Obviously, to get back on 3Q school. to obviously go back to Preston and have the first two qualifiers to qualify for the China Championship. Obviously, big prize money, ranking points, opportunity. So, pretty pleased with how it went.
Oh, can I just touch on something quickly, because I know you did make a little like empty your throat there. Who did you manage to beat to qualify for Q School with that first event?
Yeah,
who was it?
I don't know.
It was it?
It was sure, wasn't it? Hence why I'm sat in the middle.
It's someone to separate, isn't it?
Martin, how are you feeling?
Yeah, I'm feeling great, to be fair. Obviously, I went to Q School as well and got back on in the side door. A few people would say, but you know, I didn't fluke my 32 frame, so stop what people think. But yeah, I went to the first two qualifiers. Unfortunately, I didn't get through them, but funnily enough, I actually played really well. But I ran into two lads who played better, unfortunately. Me and Jimmy Robson had a great game in the Latvian tournament. He done me 4-2, but there wasn't a ball missed, I don't think, between the two of us. And then, yeah, it was for Michael White in the second tournament, which was the China one. And that was a bit disappointing because I was 2-0 up on 50, went into the pack, knocked one over the old, snooked myself on it. So I could have been going 3-0 up, ended up losing that game, but for sure.
Actually, saw a bit of that game, so you were unlucky there, because even you could have even gone 3-1, couldn't you?
He was gone a bit at that time. The queue was going about a bit, but then, you know, class players, what they do, when they nick a frame here and there, they get straight back on, and then he played really well as well, to be fair. But yeah, so no, I'm feeling good about the game anyway.
Good.
So,
Sean, what about you?
Well, apart from Q School, I didn't even realise the season had started. I thought it was next week in Preston. I didn't realise two events had
Do you not get the text, though?
No, actually not. Had a bit of a mare the first two events. Didn't really show up, didn't play well at all. Just happened. I think I was a bit hungover from Q School. It was a long couple of weeks.
Yeah.
I was quite chilled, actually.
I bet you were after.
Yeah, the week off. It was brilliant.
Yeah, no. To be fair, no, the first week at Q School, I did play out of my skin. Just ran into the better man on the day.
Listen, I said in the interview, I was over the moon, you weren't scoring and you were.
Actually, touching on that, it's a good point to mention your Q School form, because actually you dealt Alex Davies a good dose of it, didn't you? Because you actually played well against him, didn't you?
Well, someone had to shut him up.
Absolutely.
Someone had to shut him up.
But it's an interesting fact, like I said, all three of you coming through Q School, obviously all on the tour last year, we're all friends of ours and friends of all of us at Daffer Snooker. What was it like just going through that Q School experience with you guys again? Because I mean, when you've been on the tour, used to the pro circuit, the pro surroundings, it must have been tough for you guys heading back into that just so quickly after coming out of the world, you know what I mean? It's not much time, is there?
No, there wasn't much time. I experienced a lot of anxiety before I went there, but actually when I got there and started playing, I started to relax a bit, because the thing is, it's cutthroat at Q School,
yeah.
But in all fairness, the way the amateur game is and that, it's not really that fair, Q School, because you go there and you've had 2 years on the tour. You're playing lads who maybe not been on the tour. Not that they're not good players, but they're nowhere near match sharp.
Yeah.
So you can win games with your B and your C game just because you're so match sharp. And once you go through a round or two there, you realise that. And you know that unless there's the other tour players that are dropping off,
you
ain't going to get troubled that much. Yeah. Unless someone has an absolute flyer off you in a best of seven, which obviously can happen. That's the way I look at it. And that's not being disrespectful to them. It's just that they've had nothing to play in.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Right, so they've had no exposure.
Yeah.
And their whole year hinges on this 2 weeks.
Yeah.
Whereas we've played 20 odd tournaments in the last year.
I suppose not.
So, but when you go there, there's a bit of fear when you go there. But actually, once I got there, I sort of stood around and I thought, no, I ain't worried actually.
Yeah.
I know, I sort of felt like I was going to play well, and I did play well.
See, I thought that was going to be the case for you anyway, because you've gone through Q School before, haven't you?
Yeah.
So that was my first time qualifying through Q School.
Yeah.
I'd lost out twice, once to Dave Gilbert.
Dave Gilbert, yeah.
And the next time, I can't even remember who I lost to, but it was early doors, I think. And then I got on by the PTC, and I've retained my ticket by that, the 1 year list.
Yeah, yeah.
So I've never really gone through the system, whereas you have. Did you as well? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So for me, it was like sort of to get that late stage in the first event as well, thinking, oh, you know, get the job done, get it out of the way.
Yeah.
To get deeper and deeper. Like Martin was saying then, it was just purely because I think we'd all prepared well for the World Championships.
Yeah.
And obviously all the season before that. It was just a continuation. It was just another tournament, and to be fair, we sort of have an advantage just purely when you walk in the office and it's the same gentleman behind the desk, same tournament directors, you know, Paul and Martin, and it's just like, hi gentlemen, how are you? What time am I on? And it's just another tournament, so you don't really recognise that you've took a step back as such, in sort of stature. So when you start getting involved in the tournament, you played in Preston qualifiers before. It's the same venue, same practice tables, you know the drill. You've got a system for that event and that venue. And before you know it, you're sort of breaking off in the last round, and it was me and him. And it was sort of the right result, just purely because on match sharpness and you know, I would say experience more than anything.
Yeah. I mean, it's strange, like I said, it's a bit, because the Q School, the format, like Martin touched on, it's a bit of a leveller, isn't it?
Yeah.
Because the thing is, like I said, over an eight, like from say, the old playoff system,
yeah.
You knew the best eight players were generally going to get up eight tournaments.
Yeah.
It doesn't lie, does it? But like the better players, not all of the good players get immediately up from the Q School, and that's the only thing I don't like about it. Because it doesn't really, it's like if you fly for a couple of tournaments, then you're up.
Yeah.
But there's players on there, no disrespect to anybody, because I know how hard it is to be a professional snooker player, but there's players that probably, if it was eight tournaments, they probably wouldn't get up for the Q School. Do you know what I mean? We don't even mention any names, but we already know who those players are. No disrespect to them, like I said. But I just think, like you said, Mike, it's a bit of a leveller, isn't it?
It is a bit of a leveller, but having said that, if you look at the results in the last two or three Q Schools, I think 80% of people who have got on are the people who have dropped off the tour. So I don't think, you don't get that many flukes in it.
No, I agree.
I lost to...
Not saying any of you three were fluke getting boys, by the way.
I've seen a smile on your boat race, mate.
Everybody else is saying that, boys. I've got tremendous respect for all of you, you know that.
That wasn't aimed at me, by the way.
I lost to Lucas Kleckers in the last round.
Yeah.
You know, and people might think on paper, well, that's a bad result.
Yeah.
I'm experienced, he's never been on in that. The kid played well. He's gone to the World Cup, and look how well he's played.
Not only that, he had that Neil Robinson as well in Latvia, so he definitely played well.
This is what I'm saying. So, you know, there's... I don't think you get that many flukes. You can get flukes that get to like third and fourth round.
Yeah.
But you've still got to be able to stand up in that last round.
Absolutely. Yeah.
And get over the line for cash. Even though there's no cash available, but I mean, you know what I'm saying.
Yeah.
So, but it's just cutthroat. Whereas we could all draw each other first round over the two events, and then you know what I mean, you can get tough draws two events, and you get ironed out that way. It's not fair like that.
Yeah.
But hopefully this new challenge tour, what they're going to do.
Yeah.
You know, that's going to be really good for the amateurs.
Yeah, I was just going to say that then. Because that challenge tour is almost like the piles, isn't it?
Yeah.
System, sort of similar system. You know, and like you said, if someone has a good first event, I think it happened once. I think it was think it was Andrew Atkinson it was, because he was up by
Mark. I remember.
I think he got the final, the first one.
Yeah.
And then he didn't win a match in the other six or seven events.
And didn't get up.
And he didn't get on.
And rightly so.
Yeah, because you say the cream rises to the top. It's the consistency of you playing well over a season. Where I think if the Q School lads get on and someone has a very, very good week,
yeah,
I think it's just more apparent during the professional season, you know, when they're doing the tournaments. And they're turning up and getting beaten, can wear them down. Whereas I think the challenge tour system,
yeah,
it would mature the player. It would make them realise if they're good enough, when they're ready to breach onto the tour. And you know, the more match sharp and the sort of getting prepared for the onslaught, I think, of you know, I mean, like you say, there's 100 players on tour now,
yeah,
that, you know, are gonna be ready for a match.
Yeah.
Whether you pick up the phone, I'm ready today, because they're always practicing. You know, we're always playing tournaments, and if these lads are coming on and they haven't got that behind them, yeah, they're just going to get beaten up. That can help. You know, yeah, like Mark was saying then with Lucas Kleckers. I mean, he's gone. He's took the opportunity. He's obviously prepared. He's ready within himself to make that jump, and that was a little confidence and belief boost that he needed. And fair play to the lad.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I mean, my only small gripe with the new challenge tour system, as we were all talking off camera, which as Sean said as well, only two places being available. I mean, Sean,
yeah,
it's the one thing that needs to change.
Yeah,
it's been a bit more like the Pios. It's got to be 10 or 12 tour slots, I think.
Yeah, yeah.
Almost like a swap with the Q School, I think, bring them over.
Because you just think with 10 events, and you can imagine the amount of runners that are going to be in these tournaments,
yeah.
I just don't understand you can have 10 events and only two spaces.
I think maybe if it was to, because obviously there was 12 spaces in the Q School, the challenge tour, like Storm was saying, then if they had the 12 spots available, and let's say they have a ranking list as such, and you qualify for, let's say, free entry into Q School, it's like a safety net, you know, it's a second chance.
Yeah.
And then that's the pinnacle, that's like the grand finals. There's the winners of them events. You're on tour, well done. You know, so each event winner may get a ticket, or do it as a ranking system, and then at the end it's like the lucky losers, if you will, boom, you're into Q School. That's like a grand final pot of there's the other four spots up for grabs.
Because I listened to a few players talking about this a couple of weeks ago, and they were saying, look, if you think about the logistics of it anyway, you get three players win three events each, and one of them doesn't get on. That's how mad it is. Only two spots with 10 tour. I know that's how unlikely it is, but.
Yeah.
That could happen.
Of course, it could happen.
You know what I mean? Can you imagine if you're a player that won three events and you're not on, you're going to be pretty happy about it, aren't you?
Yeah, totally.
It'd be interesting to see what cash is available.
Yes,
as well.
Yeah.
But I think a good idea with that challenge tour moving forward after the first year is that, say you evened up the spots, but anyway, whoever drops off the tour and has got to go to Q School, I think they should be seeded along with the top, however many. Or that challenge tour ranking list, and when you go into Q School, you should see all of them players going into Q School.
Yeah.
So there's a reward
for
doing it. You know what I mean? And then you definitely do get the best players coming through.
Yeah, I've thought for a long time Q School should be seeded anyway, like, because it shouldn't be fair that if you and Alan have dropped off the tour, or you and Sean dropped off the tour, be able to draw each other first round in the Q School event. It's madness.
Yeah, it is madness. It is madness.
I mean, I think that's the way that's cutthroat then, because I mean, as soon as you drop off the tour, you're an amateur. That's the hard fact of it.
Yeah.
You know, so you're all in the same boat. So you can look at it that way and say, well, why should there be priorities for ex pros as such? I just think because it feels like a continuation.
Yeah.
You would almost think you get priority, but you're either on the tour or you're not.
I mean, speaking to all three of you individually during Q School as well, obviously supporting you guys as you all know. But I could tell in your voices all the pressure you feel in that event. It's like no other, isn't it? Because it's like your whole life and what you want from your life in a professional player, just in one tournament.
The first match was the most important one.
Yeah.
I think you see from the results, once you get through the first match, the better players are always there or thereabouts coming the final day.
Yeah.
They're either lose first match because it's, you know, a bit of nerves, or it's a bad draw. And I noticed that the first match was really edgy.
Who did you have first, bro?
Christian Jones.
Yeah,
3-0 down.
Yeah, I remember, yeah.
Hadn't really done much wrong.
Yeah.
I had a couple of half chances, didn't take him. He played really well. 3-0 down. And I'm thinking, well, I've got to get through the second event here.
Yeah.
Or else I'm in trouble. And I've seen people like Samson Lam lost first round, first event.
Simon Bent, didn't he? 4-0.
Yeah, and he knew then he got gold away, or else is it another year slogging around the amateur tour?
Thing is, there was a lot of pressure. There was a lot of pressure at Q School.
Yeah.
I mean, because although you touched on it, I've been through there and qualified before, but the last time I dropped off the tour, I went to Q School and I didn't get back on.
Yeah.
And that was hard because all of my mates were on, apart from you, yeah. Right? And everyone's going off to tournaments.
Yeah.
And you've got nothing to play in.
Yeah, yeah, I remember that
year, I stuck my neck out and I went to a couple of Asian PTCs and get some tournament play, right? Financially, it made no sense whatsoever. Obviously playing the PTCs, and that's actually how I got back on that year. I was like, you know, that whole year I think my earnings were something stupid like 800 quid.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Because I had been through that, there was pressure there, because I was thinking, what the hell am I going to do if you don't get through?
I
was turning 31.
Yes,
you know, whilst you could have 15 years in the game now, maybe 20, right? You can't if you're not on the tour, because there's no earning opportunity, which is where hopefully the Challenge Tour will come in. And I'm hoping that, you know, the winner of them events are going to be getting something like $5,000 or something, you know, so people can start living. Because they're, you know, there's really good money in the pro game now.
Yeah.
I don't think anyone can argue about the pro game. They've just released a list for the prize money this year. I think if you win all your first round games this year, right, it's close to $50,000.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, 50, right, 52 grand it is.
Right. Well, there you go.
Yeah.
So that's just for winning one match. All right, everyone's not going to win one match in every event, but you know, you might win two in one. You know, you can. Money's good now. So,
yeah.
But at Q School, there is that fear. My God, I've got 12 months. You know, yeah. I've got to get a job.
No, I appreciate it, honestly, Bob. Like you said, I know the pressure that was on you guys. You know what I mean? It's saying it's like it's all the tremendous getting through.
To just constantly dismiss it, like,
Do you know what? I got nervous energy just talking about it. That's how
much
pressure there was.
Yeah, I know, I remember, Paul. Yeah. I do remember.
Weird.
No. You
don't want to be there again.
He was feeling pressure, right? In the last event, I'm sitting at home with the draw and how many points and frames everyone's on, and I'm thinking, if he beats him and he beats him, he needs to win 3 frames and he can't lose to him, and he's got. My head was wrecked, and I'm sitting at home, cushy, tour. I'm trying to work out what these two have got to do.
Let me raise you a bit, mate. I was on holiday. I was in Cyprus, and I'm watching these two do that. I'm thinking, I'm refreshing the page on the beach. I'm like, what's going on here, mate? Can't get any 4G going. I'm speaking to them after each match, so yeah, anyway, all glad you were.
That's
the main thing. Swiftly moving on, boys. August the 1st to the 9th, we're all in Preston. 3 events back to back. How's preparation been for those tournaments, boys? Firstly, with Ushaw.
Been alright, yeah. I haven't been going too mad with the practice, trying to enjoy the weather as much as I could. Gone out for a yacht round of golf here and there.
I've heard.
Bandito.
Yeah. We won't speak about that.
I can't believe you didn't bring your trophy with you.
I can't believe what I was.
Let's just say I've earned more money this season at golf than I have known. But yeah, no, I've still been putting the hours in. Just trying to balance it, really. But now it's going to be a couple of weeks of hard graft and getting ready.
Good man, mate.
Yeah, same. My prep's been a bit different to what I would normally do. But it's been such a long season on tour because we went to Q School. No respite, and then you had the qualifier straight after Q School. So I took a couple of weeks off, and as you know, mate, I'm a big practicer, so you know, I got a nosebleed when I took 2 weeks off.
That's because you're miserable. You're over the end of the queue. I'm trying to get back to court.
There's no talent sat here, mate. It's just practice, right? So yeah, my prep's been a bit different, and then. I've been doing a bit of coaching, but I've played a few golf days, so I haven't really had like solid weeks practice. I've had I've been in the club for 2 days, and I've had a golf day, then I've had 2 days, and we've had a fair bit of golf and stuff. So my practice has been staggered, but to be honest, I needed it. It was such a long 12 months.
Yeah.
I just needed it, and now you know, last week or so it's been head down. Can't wait to get going again.
Yeah. I mean, you made a good point about needing a break, because it's such a mental game, and the mental strength you need, the mental capacity that you just get put through throughout the season, it does come to that point where you just need to completely switch off, isn't it, and just put the cue down and not even think about the game.
Yeah.
You like,
got to recharge the battery.
Yeah, come back fresh.
Got to, especially say, especially because we were all in the Q school, and you see how like how heavy,
yeah,
like, you know, it was. And even when I came back, obviously I was watching these boys open that he got through, and I was drained. You know, you just spend 2 or 3 days just sitting around, just like sort of, you know, just
you were drained. How do you think I was?
Well, to be fair, I didn't care anyway. I just wished you got on. You know, just my pals and that, but hey.
Worst thing about it, right? That last day, I didn't eat all day, right? I was waiting for the results, obviously. I just couldn't eat. And the result obviously went my way. And all I wanted to do is go and have 10 gallons of Guinness and just get off my face. 3 weeks, and I thought, well, you can't because I've got qualified in 7 or 8 days. Yeah. I can't even do that. Because I hadn't eaten one glass of champagne, I'd have been on the floor.
I'll tell you what was funny, because the last day at that Q school, I actually got back from holiday. So I've got home now, and I've got him on the phone, because he was already up now. I've got him on the phone, and we're talking, we've got the iPad in front of him, refreshing the scores, and I know that he needed two matches to go his way. So then he said, "Oh, it's not going to happen." I said, "It's going to happen, mate. Just relax. It's going to, it ain't going to happen." He goes, "Oh, I'll ring you back. I'll ring you." I was on off the phone about 10 times, obviously, in the space of an hour and a half. And then finally, when the results were going to go, I ran out. I said, "No!" He squished out. And then he goes, hilarious.
Go Lazio.
Yeah, it was like the old Channel 4 pretending football. Go Lazio. I'm so happy for him, do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because we spoke, like I said before, about getting back on that. So yeah, it was brilliant. So, what about your prep, Al? How's your prep?
Yeah, I mean, yesterday after Q school, just switched off for a few days completely.
Yeah.
But I mean, I'm lucky enough to imagine the club's across the street from where I live.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you know, sort of drifted in like a, you know, proud peacock and was like, ask me how I got on type of thing, you know what I mean? I thought it was still going on. I said, it is, boys, it is. But, no, I mean, I just had a few, like, friendly frames with the lads in the club, you know, and just sort of just chilled out, a bit of free play, really, you know, nothing serious. And then, yeah, as the lad said, it was straight back to work. Qualifiers up in Preston, so and I say, because we've been through the season, the well qualifiers, the Q school, that you felt like your prep was always going to be there for the first qualifiers, and it was more of a case of recharging the batteries more than practicing, because you didn't need to put the hours in as such. You just needed to be mentally ready.
Just refresh yourself.
Yeah,
and
for when you put your suit on again.
Yeah.
You know, and luckily for me. You know, I managed to qualify through one of the events, and I think that was purely because of the success I had in Preston last season, Q school, and then the qualifiers were back in Preston.
Yeah.
So again, it was just a constant flow of tournaments and memories that I was going down there.
Yeah.
But since then, sort of took a slight backseat, doing a couple of solid days, you know, a few relaxed days. But I've just come back from Beijing. Because I do a bit of coaching as well, and two of my lads qualified for the World Unders.
Yeah.
Young lad from Ireland, Roland White.
Yeah.
He qualified for the under 18s and 21s. And Matt Glasby, who done an interview with Daffa Snooker not so long back, for the under 21s, saying that it was just nice for me to be out there and see them sort of perform in a big championship, and be around like a venue and see how the amateur game's getting on globally, internationally, over in the academy in Beijing. And as a coach capacity, to see and overlook all these other players and deal with other head coaches. We had a brief conversation with Wayne Griffiths there, he's dealing with the Hong Kong team, and just seeing how different systems work. And I say with my close connection with the Irish team, PJ Nolan as well, another good coach. And
I think Martin's enjoying him.
I think he is.
Of course, you're digging, mate.
Sorry, Albert. Them chocolate biscuits are absolutely different path, mate.
You see, the only way to stop me talking is to shove food in front of me, so any chance you're passing me one over, boy, you're lost.
Well, guys, I'm not saying the chocolate bit, they weren't ever selection,
sorry,
mate.
No. But anyway, back to me, yeah?
Back to you, I'll be
the competitiveness
you,
around the table.
Correct, I can feel it already, man. I feel the tension there already, man. Do you know what I mean?
Nah, but yeah, I mean, I took my cue over there.
Of course you did.
Yeah, I had a little sneaky practice. You never take your foot off the gas.
No, correct.
But yeah, now I'm back, same as these boys, you know, straight back to it. Hopefully can get me tablecloth soon, and ready for the season again.
Good man.
Well, I'd like to touch on there being no entry fees this season. How much has that helped you guys? A lot, I'd imagine.
Humongous, yeah.
Yeah.
Humongous. I think that was part of the stress relief.
Yeah.
From Q school.
Yeah.
You know, it's not like, oh, you frame a match ball, you're back on tour, and you go, always be Waller.
You know, it's a thing. It's huge, isn't it?
Yeah,
it's a huge help. Especially coming from Q School, you've just done a grand at least.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Well, I did loads more than that because I was there for the 2 weeks.
Yeah.
But
yeah, but you always eat well. That's why. You know, no happy shoppers.
Hold on.
What are you saying?
Hey, you know what I'm saying?
Hey, I'm 10 stone soaking wet. What's up, yo? I don't mean you're like large in form. I just mean like, you know, you like fancy places.
I think he just means the quality of the food that you like to eat well.
Yeah, but how was that bar and brew I stuck you into?
Taste it, yeah.
Oh, well, hang on a minute, is that the one that we didn't manage to get into him? Was that the one? Because somebody did manage to book it. Is that the one?
Yeah.
Well, just give me
another. Listen, mate, you won't go with me. This is what happens, mate.
But guys, you know what, to be fair, guys, on a bit of a series, I think Emma's raised a great question there, because especially as all three of you are outside of 64, and as a lot of our pals are outside and inside of 64, but I think she makes a great point about the MGVs. They're going to make a huge difference to you guys over the next couple of years.
It's massive. It's four grand you don't have to find.
Yeah.
Right? Straight away. Four grand you don't have to find. It's just going to help us outside the 64.
Yeah.
I've spoken to players inside the 64.
Absolutely.
About it. That's how the financial pressure is taken.
Agreed.
Right? Yeah. But, you know, snooker is now, they're doing such a great job now, I think.
Yeah, they are.
You know what I mean? They took the entry fees away. First round checks are going up every year.
Yeah.
You know, I couldn't believe that the world's check went up again.
Yeah, £9,000 this year.
Yeah.
£9,000 first hit, didn't it?
You know.
Yeah. I'll tell you what, boys.
A lot of pop box going around.
I was just about to say that. I tell you what, boys. Small amount of twitching there. Nine each on the black. Just for the nine large. Because you know what it's like, boys.
That's what you want, though, isn't it? You want great.
It's like that final black bean. What? It's either going to be Tenerife with the missus, or it might be a trip to Brighton, isn't it?
Okay.
£9,000 or nothing, isn't it?
Brighton.
Of the day.
Get the Brighton if I don't win it. It's about a nifty on the train, leave it. I'll be going down the park.
But you know what?
O'Donnell on the swings.
Life
scores, like, oh, refresh.
I say, this is until I pop that final black down, it's as good as it gets, sweetheart. But I mean, like, even coming round to the big events, like I remember talking to Alan last year, hey, like, even when the world's come round and you think to yourself, it might not sound bundles to the outside world, but £700 is still a lot to stump up for one tournament.
Nice.
And you get it from all sorts of places, talking to them like, oh, the world's going to find 700, but then you look at an hotel, it's basically find another grand, isn't it?
Yeah.
Travel expenses, and you know, it just takes that pressure.
You just don't have to think about it.
Cash
flow's
been a big problem for players on tour.
Yeah.
You know, especially like some of the events, like China and stuff like that, you know, it's just 10, 12 weeks before you're getting paid. So, you know, if you've done well in the tournament and you're owed a few grand and stuff, so cash flow can be a problem. So no entry fees is massive. It's,
yeah, because then that's your expenses.
They've done, I didn't actually think that would be something that would come into the game. But it's really surprising when it happened. Fair play to
you. Sure, what did it mean to you, Paul, obviously, with the entry fees? I know you've had a sponsor the last couple of years, but still, that must have been a bit of pressure taken off him as well.
Yeah, I mean, I'm lucky to have Stirling Star sponsoring me. I've been for the last 5 years. Probably didn't mean as much as other people.
It meant a lot to him, I think.
He's
in Tenerife now.
He's the one in the not me. Of course, it still helps. I think throughout the season, the first round matches now, the standard will go up.
Yeah.
Because people aren't worried about, all they've got to worry about is their hotels.
Yeah.
And that's it. So I do think, like, you look at people like Kleckers. Was it Kleckers that beat Robertson?
Yeah.
Things like that will happen more now, I think, because everyone's a lot more relaxed at venues for the first round match. You're not having to worry. I think people will start upping their game.
Yeah.
And the first round matches will be, you'll see a lot more bigger breaks.
Yeah, probably. Just
because. Won't be as twitchy.
I would say them entry fees, you know instantly that after this tournament, you've got an email off World Snooker there, and I need to find X amount. And straight away, you know you can get to the next event without, you know, you can look at that pot of money and it's just halved straight away.
Yeah.
Whereas them entry fees can be a flight, hotel, some petrol in your car, so at least you know you can get to the next event.
Yeah, and just focus more on the
snooker. I mean, we've all been there. You know, you're looking at your bank and you're just like, what's going on? And you've got, like Sean was saying, you've got to find money, speculate to accumulate, you've got to get there to give yourself the chance. And you've got all this stress and worry about money
shouldn't be the case in this day and age, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But again, Wales snooker, they're giving you opportunities.
Yeah, well, they are. They
you
really
know, if you can put the work in and you can get there and you can win your first game, oh, you can relax because now the next X amount of tournaments are all settled, they're paid for.
Yeah,
once
brilliant.
You get paid, you know what I mean?
And like Martin said, you touched on it with the first round check going up as much as they are, you're actually playing for a nice little chunk. I mean, even like the home internationals, it might not sound like, but £2,500 for your first match is still a decent chunk
it's
for
decent
first,
chunk,
isn't it?
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
It's a decent chunk.
Yeah, I mean, the China Championships was 4,000, and I think a lot of these Chinese events are now creeping up towards that amount, three and four. So, you know, it's covering your expense, it's covering your flights, it's covering your exes while you're out there, and you're still making a little bit of money.
Yeah.
I say going on like what sort of gripes us on tour, and I think that was, I mean, the players say it a lot, it's just payments, you know, the Chinese events are behind the times with the promoters paying it 8 to 10 weeks, it's too long. There's no other job that you would have to wait that long.
Yeah.
You know, maximum you're getting paid weekly or monthly, and it's as simple as that. But I think that it is in hand, or should be at least, you know, just to try and speed that process up. And that would give the lower ranked players, we've all been there, obviously come on and off the tour, and you see both sides of the fence where there's amateur players who are almost better off than lower ranked pros because they haven't got the pressures, you know, of that continual travel and entry fees, and when they pick and choose, they're obviously picking and choosing due to their bank balance.
Yeah.
I can afford to go in there, I'll do that. Whereas if you want to stay on tour and reach the 64 and climb higher, you know, you've got to enter everything, stick your neck on the line, and it's a harsh reality, but finance is a massive thing.
Yeah.
So to get paid quicker, you know, and the cash flow just constantly there.
Yeah.
If you, like you were saying, if you can win your first round matches and you're earning up towards £50,000, well, happy days. If you can get your hands on it, even happier.
Well, I think that's what we told you from China, isn't it? Like you get deep in the China tour. I remember Martin didn't once, I think someone else won around 10 once as well. And you know, you've got like 10 large to come, you're like, 10 large is a nice lump, it'd be even better right at the end, you know what I mean?
Exactly.
Yeah, and you go home, and this is the thing, you've got 10 lump coming, right? And where are we going on Monday? Well, we ain't going anywhere for 3 months.
I'll let you know 3 months time when I've got it.
You can't go on the travel agency, I've got equity, you know what I mean? It doesn't work.
Can World Snooker just write us an IOU?
Yeah.
See if that worked on the travel agent.
He's definitely going to get that, though, don't worry, he's getting it.
No, but it's massive now, like I said before, with the first round checks going up, you win your first round of the Worlds now, that's your whole season paid for.
Yeah, agreed.
X's.
Yeah.
Agreed. The whole season paid for.
Mm. Agreed.
Massive. And you've got another 20 tournaments to fire it.
Yeah, no, it makes a massive difference.
Never
it?
Been a better time to be a pro.
Top points, okay. Top points.
True, that, true.
Well, I know you've all got girlfriends. Taylor.
Fiancé.
You
don't
have a fiancé. Congratulations.
Thank you very kindly.
How has she said yes?
How is she?
She is
how
a jackpot,
said yes.
Absolute jackpot. Hey, listen. Here we go.
She is at the jackpot, isn't she?
She has, mate.
Yeah. She won the lottery.
She has.
You can pay me that nifty,
mate. Yeah. She's won the lottery. I'm surprised. Before we started the film, he said she won at the bingo.
No, so what I wanted to ask you all was how you find being away from your partners, and you know, all the travelling, and you're always away, so
I think
is it
she
easy?
Loves it.
She loves it? Probably with you, yeah.
Gets me out, keeps the house quiet. To be fair, I don't know, I try not to think about it, do you know what I mean? Because when you are far away, are you in China or India or somewhere like that, and if you stop to think about far away you are from home, You can get a bit homesick, you know, you're lonely. On tour, you're always in, you know, in your hotel room, you know, you're going to practice, we're going to eat, and if the lads are there, then we all meet up and have food, but in the background, there's still that little buzz of whatever tournament's here. You know, don't let your guard down, you know, you sort of keep yourself locked in.
Yeah.
I mean, obviously, lucky now with the internet and FaceTime and text and
it's a lot
all
easier
that.
Too.
Yeah, it's a lot easier, but still,
it's bad enough having to suffer your face when you're there, never mind over FaceTime and China, mate. Jeez, give poor girl a break, mate. What's wrong with
you? No, she said yes, leave her alone.
Lovely school this, isn't it, eh?
Good point, Em, good point.
Martin, what's it like for you? Is it something you get used to, or is it like Alan said, you just have to kind of keep that to the back of your mind?
He's more of a man than me, I think.
it's hard. It's hard being away from home. It's hard when you go away and if you haven't won, and you're coming home and you're like, oh, I'll wait for another 2 or 3 days, you know, and it weren't really worth it, sort of thing. But if you're winning matches and you're coming home, you go, like there's a bit of buzz about it.
Yeah.
It's not too bad. But I found it hard because you realise what they go through. So my other half is from Poland. And she's gone to Poland a couple of times without me, which is not normal, that would normally happen. But when she has, my God, our flat is like so lonely. You're on your own. I do like my own space, but it's weird. So you're in the flat and you're like,
it's like echoing almost.
Yeah. And there's no one to talk to, right?
So I talk to myself.
So, yeah. See, I'm not at that stage.
Okay.
But so, and then it ticks in your mind. So when I go away now, it ticks in my mind. I'm thinking she's lonely in the flat. And like you say, there's FaceTime and there's Skype and stuff like that. So you're always in contact with them.
Yeah.
But you know, it's not easy. But if you're winning and you're successful, it becomes
easier. Yeah.
But it's still not easy. It's still not easy.
What about you, Sean?
Yeah, I mean, I think I deal with it quite well. Like Alan said, when you're out in China, you're with all the lads anyway, so you know, your mind's not on it.
Occupied,
you know, you've got other
yeah.
things going on. But then you do think, you know, they're sort of, they're at home, then no one there, a little bit lonely. So, like Martin said as well, winning, making the trip worth it makes
yeah.
all the difference.
Yeah.
And something that when I spoke to Becky's things to work on is when we are at home, do more things together.
Yeah.
Quality time.
Date night.
Yeah.
Date
night.
Well, that's what you mean. See, when you win,
like yeah.
you can come back and you
yeah.
take them out for a bit.
Yeah, exactly.
You can't wait. Date.
With
so date,
steak
date
club.
Date night planned 3 months. I'll wait for a check.
Yeah, well, Alan, have you taken the creams yet, though? Have you
no.
taken? Mate, come
I
on.
Thought that was our thing.
No, that's
creams.
Our thing. And
creams.
Your thing.
What's this? Creams.
Oh, listen, lovely little dessert place
so
that me Alan discovered near his house.
Yeah.
And I said to her, this would be a perfect place for date night with the missus, mate. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Show a bit of class on you. That's wrong,
mate.
I'm
going to have to, yeah, I'm going to have to.
Good
he's
mate.
Waiting to be paid from China, leave him out
there. Right, boys and girls, we're all football fans around the table. We've got a mixed bag today as well, which is also always good. We've got a Blue Nose fan, Everton fan in.
When I want to be.
When he wants to be.
Yeah.
When in the rare occasion they do either draw or beat Liverpool, which I can't remember when because I'm clueless.
Right.
And he constantly reminds
exactly.
me.
Exactly. You haven't been a Liverpool fan for quite a few years.
No.
Okay.
I mean,
how they been getting on in the Merseyside?
Is that 14 derbies in a row?
Yeah.
Yeah, just the 14, yeah?
See, that's the last time I watched it.
Well,
Duncan Ferguson's still in goal, yeah?
Still no, mate. Still no. Well, as we've got a mixed bag around the table. We've got a Blue Nose fan. In O'Donnell, O'Donnell, in Alan Taylor. Me and O'Donnell are big Liverpool fans. We've got a big gooner on the end, Storm, and my co-presenter, who I call now the enemy, because she's a Man United fan. So there's even a line drawn between us here.
She's been kept quiet.
I'm not apologising.
Scumchester over there.
Yeah, she's a big United fan, so you know what it's like when you're not a Liverpool player. We do not speak that day, full stop. Do you know what I mean? But
we might sometimes go to the same place to watch.
Oh yeah, yeah. Oh, I should let you know about the setup we've got. Actually, Emma will tell you about the setup we've got.
Well, no, we're just miles apart, aren't we?
Yeah,
we're
go and watch
the
game.
Same
vicinity, but no.
Don't know you. I don't really.
No, can't sit with them, mate. Can't sit.
I'll just get a lift there and back. That's all.
That's nice, isn't it? But yeah, touching with you first, Al. With Everton this season, what do you think of Everton's chances this year, mate?
No idea. The NQ school.
Can I just say, I'm not happy you guys have got Rooney back. I'm not happy about that.
So he doesn't know that.
I
heard
about
that.
I
heard
about that the other day.
I heard that.
Where did he come from? He's one of yours, mate.
He thought he was still at Everton.
He thought he never moved.
See, that's the thing. The last time I watched, he was playing, and now he's playing again. I think nothing's changed. Like Coronation Street.
We
you
got him.
Have to watch it for
and
years.
Now you've got him back.
He saw the screen we scored against Arsenal about 12 years ago, or wherever long ago it was.
Yeah, that was it.
And
that was the last time.
Nice to see you're not still sore about that goal.
That was a good
era. Going back 12 years.
That was a good era.
What's
that,
to be fair,
that was the same face you gave me when I thought you were a yid.
But to be honest, mate, to be fair, Rooney's hairline was receding when he was 16, it's receding now, so I don't blame you still thinking he's still there, mate.
What
not much of a change.
You said that for?
No one said anything about you. You're not going to feel on top of yourself?
I'm trying to do the Essex sweep, but it's more of a comb over, if I'm honest, like.
Yeah?
What?
No comment, Your Honour.
Look at the confidence in him now, man.
I know, he's got the old sweep going on, Sean, already.
My hairline ain't the best either, so I'm saying nothing.
OD.
I've got like 8 years on you, so.
We're both big Liverpool fans, Paul. Big season for us this year, isn't it?
It's a massive season for us, mate. It's a massive season for us. We've got, in my opinion...
Well, you've got...
Can't say he's the best manager in the world, but I wouldn't swap him for another manager.
Yeah.
And I think this season's going to be a big year, and hopefully if he can get the transfers over the line that he's looking for, they'll really make the difference to us. You know, because last year, up to Christmas, before we started getting injuries, we were... the team in the league, obviously.
Yeah, absolutely.
You've got another team playing better football than us.
You've got that Mohamed Salah, haven't you?
Yeah.
And he's a great signing for you because he's quite quick and direct, isn't he?
Yeah,
fair point. He is.
He looks a really good signing, but you don't know. I mean, he didn't really get a chance at Chelsea, but he didn't really look much at Chelsea. Mm. So it'll be interesting to see how he plays in the Premier League again. But we've been talking a bit off camera, the back players we've got, and I'm like, this is the first time since the Benitez days I don't know our first 11, right? Which is great, because then you think...
Absolutely, because I don't know Everton's first 11.
But Martin, I think Emma makes a good point about the Salah signing. I think that's massive for us, you know, because like you said, he is quick and he is direct.
Yeah.
And I really think that, you know what?
And we struggled without Mane.
Exactly. So I think she's right. That's a massive signing for us there, to be fair, you know.
And to be fair, I didn't know much about the Chelsea kid, Solanke, but he's obviously scored a good goal yesterday.
Yeah, he did, yeah.
He looked decent, to be fair. So, you know, he's one for the future, but I think he could probably play a bit this year. And we just need to be lucky with injuries. I'm a big fan of Danny Ings.
I think
hopefully he'll be back in the side by Christmas, right? Because he's had two bad injuries, so he's going to take a lot of time to get back fit. But it's going to be interesting, mate. I think the brand of football we play, the manager we've got, what he expects, and the team spirit that's there.
Yeah.
I think, you know, I think we'll go close. I really do.
Make a prediction.
Eh? Top two, I think we'll go.
Cool. On.
And the reason I say top two is because I think if Chelsea get Aubameyang, If they get Aubameyang, I don't know, mate. I can't see anyone beating them.
That might seal it for them, to be fair.
City are in trouble. They got to go and spend another $300 million. City. Yeah. They're just
a 300.
Well, they're just, you know, he's picked up an aging squad there.
Yeah.
There's a lot of dead wood in there, so I don't see City being that much throughout the whole season. They're going to be in the top four. Wenger's got a nosebleed. He should pay 50-odd mil for Lacazette. Is he feeling all right?
Yeah, I was a bit surprised by that. But I think he's still got to spend another 50 or 60 mil. To be honest, on a couple of players.
But that Lacazette, he's top quality striker, isn't he?
Well, you would have thought he's a top quality striker, right? But the thing, the fact about it is, he's behind Giroud in the France pecking order.
Yeah.
Do you know what, Mark? You're right. And that's the thing that proves me. Because I rate him. I rate Lacazette. I think he's quality, mate.
Yeah.
And like Emil was saying, I think that is a top signing for him.
It's probably political, I think, with France.
Yeah. I think so as well. Because he's a better player than Giroud.
It's like a Nelka. He was class for years, but he never got in the France side. It's all political.
Same with Benzema as well.
Yeah.
So. To be fair, that it's probably what they've needed for a while as well, a top quality striker, as you say anyway, because you guys have.
I think they need him for sure, though, mate.
But they've always had this problem with the number nine, haven't you? Since Henry's left, Lacazette is exactly what you need now, isn't it? To be fair, somebody's going to get him behind the lines, and
if we can keep Sanchez, if it's a big
if, can't see that happening, I should.
Well,
don't have to press him.
I don't see why they'd keep him unless he's going to sign a new contract, otherwise take the money and buy some more players.
Because
there's plenty of players who put a shift in like he does.
Not as good though, he's a special player.
Not as good quality, but I think if we can get someone like Mahrez in, maybe that Lamar,
good player, Lamar.
Maybe next season.
One from Monaco, good player.
He's from Fame Academy, he's the one we want down the
wing. You might get him, I think it's just 50-50.
This is what you get from Evertonian, guys. Do you know what I mean?
All these plays, you sound like desserts on a Michelin star restaurant.
I suppose, guys, you better ask the enemy about our team now, not about United. What do you guys chance this year, love?
Oh, you're just going to just... dig me out now all day, aren't you?
Of course we are. I want to know your opinion on United as well, to be fair.
Well, I think it's Paul Pogba's second season now.
Yeah.
So I think he'll be a better player for that.
Yeah, he will be for sure. Would you rate him up?
Yeah, he will be. But he's, I don't know, for me, he needs help.
He's not that good as
innings out.
He's
not for that money. He's not that good.
United, whoever's behind all the transfers at United, they need sacking. You let academy geezer go for nothing and then sign him a couple of years later for 90 million. I mean, how can that geezer still be in a job?
I think the only strange thing, the only thing I would say about that, Mark, to be fair, like, his performances for Juventus were excellent, weren't they?
Yeah.
But agreeing with you, he didn't come, he didn't set the world alight last year, but I think that might be right. The fact they've been second season now, back in the team.
Yeah, it'd be better. It'd be better for sure. And he needs better players around him, which I'm sure Mourinho will sign. He'll spend another 400 million.
It's his second season now, isn't it, Mourinho? So I think that'll have a great impact on the team.
Yeah,
and then
with us
winning the Europa League last year, I can see us picking up some trophies this year.
She's glowing already. United fans glowing already. She knows her stuff, though.
You can't argue with it. I mean, in my opinion, you had a poor side last year and won three cups. Mm.
But that's the feeling, that's what he does.
They're a massive. I see United as a massive rebuilding job. You know, since Ferguson left at a clever time, you know, that's probably his worst United team he won the league with.
Yeah.
And he's, you know, that squad's need clear now. Quite a long time.
Well, just be prepared for us to pick up some trophies this year, boys. Yeah,
guys, I tell you, we'll
not wait for it.
If you want a little wager on who finishes higher, Emma, I'll take it, darling. Don't worry about it.
Quality, boys. Quality.
So,
all these boys fancy themselves in the kitchen.
I was just gonna say.
Especially this one on the right here, who promises Arabiata sauces and all that.
Yeah, but then you get taken to where? Nando's?
Not only that, getting the field dropped on me and all, do you know what I mean?
And
that,
you pay.
That's the worst thing. But that's a scouser for you, anyway. That is a scouser for you.
I know.
They give you all this bill, I'll take you for a meal, and when the bill comes, they start whistling.
But did you know this? I wasn't there that day.
No, I knew
that would happen. So I thought, I'm not coming all the way there to get given Nando's.
I agree, sweetheart. I fully agree, though.
So I stayed at home.
But you're all three fancy yourselves in the kitchen, so what is your signature dish, Adam?
Hey, you don't mind. You don't mind, mate. Spicy arrabbiata.
Oh, here we go.
Although, of late. Now, Singapore fried rice.
Oh, you like that?
And that's a bit of me, though.
Is that a bit of you?
It is a bit of me.
He orders it every single
time. I always order that
time.
Singapore.
Yeah,
I love it.
Next time you come to me, order it, and I'll...
He won't eat any other rice.
No, she loves me, I'm telling you. Singapore fried rice is me, definitely. In a nutshell, when I go to Chinese. Well, you know that. We've been in Tang enough times to get rid of Preston, all of us, haven't we?
Yeah, we have indeed, yeah.
Do you know what I mean? I'm sure we'll be making a visit to Tang again, the five of us again, Preston, for sure.
Yeah,
I enjoyed that.
Hey, Tang, that's free advertising for you guys.
Yeah.
Respect to the free meal guys, right? Letting you know that, yeah. We've mentioned you three times, eh? You know what I mean? Sean, you know you're a bit of a gym guy, mate.
Yeah, but I wouldn't say I'm a master in the kitchen. My mum and dad, they know how to cook.
Do you cook Becky any dishes? Has she got a favourite that you do for her?
Not really. Whatever I'll eat, she'll eat. If I'm putting on a bit of steak...
She's a lucky girl.
Yeah.
do you want to finish that?
You definitely go out and wait for her, didn't you?
I'm having piri-piri chicken tonight, and if you don't like it...
I'd rather take her out to a restaurant than cook her food, to be honest.
Nando's, yeah. He's got 45 chilies on his
Nando's.
he just can't bear to cash him in case he's on date night. I'll tell you where we can go along for a change.
I'll tell you what, Sean, you ain't wrong. You don't buy a Nando's, do you, bro?
Yeah. He's got 40% shares in him. What are you on about?
He's always there.
It's an investment.
we were in Preston, and we all had dinner in an Italian,
right,
and it was belting down with rain, and I lent Sean my brolly so he could go on his own to Nando's.
he suffered the rain, suffered the storms, just rather up a bit. Imagine, I suffered the storm, for the storm, rather a bit of chicken.
What sort of geezer walked out of an Italian? Italian food.
He sat with us for a while, kept us company. I'm sure you had some bananas on you and all, Sean. I don't
know
why.
Yeah,
I remember.
Yeah, he had bananas. He did.
I guarantee you had a Kit Kat on him.
And,
only on the golf course.
Right? That's it. What about you? What about you, Emma? Like me and Emma have heard that you're a bit...
You can do a cracking salad. I know that.
You keep on United fans. Is this pre-packet? You were spoiled? Pick a window.
See, the thing is, at home, me and Anna, we're a bit of a team, so we always cook together.
Kids.
But yeah, I wouldn't say I'm a great chef. Like, I don't make my sauces from scratch. scratch and stuff
like that. No, we
didn't
like say chef. We said cook. We didn't say chef.
But like, we do.
Good point, though. That's a big difference, chef and a cook. Wait,
I do a nice Thai red curry, chicken curry. One of my favourite dishes is a chicken and chorizo pasta bake.
That sounds nice.
I do as well, yeah.
That's what I've been hearing about for quite a while.
Oh,
no, you
threatening to come around for a year.
Well, do I get an invite or am I out now? Am I out one of these windows?
Tell you what, when you're a United fan, the invites go down at an alarming rate when you're a United fan.
You've got some making up to do, that's what I'm saying.
Alright, fair enough.
To be fair though, I never used to be good at cooking. I think I used to be an oven chip man, you know, like you get the temperature and I thought I was successful.
Yeah.
Aoife's, my other half, she's a food technology teacher in high school.
Oh, really?
So I learnt all my skills from her.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
She's quality in the kitchen, to be fair.
Yeah, she is. Never uses scales, never measures nothing, but it always turns out, yeah.
Well, to be fair, she taught you how to make a decent sausage sandwich, because that day I came around, that was pretty decent.
Yeah, see, that used to be my signature, now I've raised the bar now.
Give him credit for a sausage sandwich.
No, but you see, the thing is, the sausages were cooked perfectly, they were nice. I've got to say, it was lovely.
See, but since I've been with Aoife, she's raised me and I do evening meals now as well, you see.
All right, okay.
Which I think I knew the reasons behind it, because when she's late from work and she puts the call in, it's got to be on the table when
we
she gets
in. We know what we're doing. We train you guys up. We know what we're doing.
Well, this is the thing, isn't it? Because I didn't really cook much before I was with Anna either, so I think that's what the ladies do to you. And it becomes enjoyable. Like when we first started going out, it was bang, bottle of wine, start cooking, you know, and it started to become enjoyable, and then you get into it a bit.
Yeah.
I mean, I weren't really into cooking when I was younger, but now.
I've still got to try and negotiate, you know, the who cooks, who washes the dishes type of scenario.
Now, whoever cooks washes up. I mean, sorry, whoever cooks.
The other one does the washing up. Right. That's the 50-50 part as well. Well, what happens in my house, because we both cook together. And you both wash up then? Get a dishwasher. No, get a dishwasher. Problem solved. You just start winning the female matches to start kicking the kitchen out there. Guys,
I just want to touch on something about the gym for a minute, because a lot of players on tour talk about their co-presenter, she's been in the gym recently and all getting her guns out and all that. Beautiful. But a lot of the boys on tour have talked about physical fitness and mental fitness being hand in hand. So I know Sean and likes the gym. Albino has been thinking about the gym for the last...
Yeah, I used to go to the gym because they had this great chocolate machine in the corner. Like, they've done them duo Snickies, you know, the ones with two. Oh, man, get through three a day, I think. That's definitely the part of my game.
You've done a lot of weight, haven't you?
Yeah, you jumped on
that bike over there when he first...
He did, yeah, guys. We actually got an exercise bike in here because we're actually at Frames Academy, where the exercise bike was actually bought for Kurt and Jimmy White, and it's been used probably about once in the last 2 years.
No, twice in the last two years.
The only reason I jumped on it because it was the closest street after scaling the stairs.
Well, the Whirlwind's done very well. He's lost a great deal of weight, but not on the bike, hasn't he?
I don't know
where he's losing it, but
he just likes to put his Puma tracksuits on and go running around the block, mate. It's a great sight.
Yeah, I lost a lot of weight, but that was just purely diet and, you know, just being conscious of what I was eating and drinking and stuff. And I was back home just before I got on tour. I used to live up north, and you know, you sort of get into the mix of all my mates have got normal jobs, if you will, and. The odd evening or the weekends, you go to the pub and have a few pints, and it's just a social where, you know, moving down south with Aoife, we didn't have that social connection with anyone, so we were just sort of indoors, you know, cooking and just going to work and back, and it's sort of over the couple of years, I think I lost about 4 stone, I think.
Yeah.
You know, I was a big lad. Looking back on the photos now, it's scary, like how
we
got
that. That's why she said yes.
Correct.
She's seen the potential.
You said, get rid of that timber, boy, and I might say yes.
It took me a while, yeah. Got the message in the end. But yeah, definitely like the fitness side of things. Obviously, weight loss is one thing, but the fitness side, you know, where, see, I've done a bit of running in the past, but for me, when I used to go away to tournaments, it was hard to maintain that. You know, you try and look now for hotels with a gym.
Yeah.
You take your running trainers and you go for a spin around the block just to keep on top of it. But that was always one that sort of fell away for me when I went away at tournaments, because my priority was just to keep myself chilled, relaxed. And I didn't actually see the importance of the fitness side, you know, where you get more energy when you exercise, and obviously like the mental well-being. And
yeah,
I mean, I'm working with Chris Henry, and he's very much on the mental side of the coaching thing, and it's just massive how much just a little bit of exercise now and again just keeps you topped up,
yeah,
and keeps your mind fresh that you can think clearly about stuff.
They say fit body, fit mind, don't
they?
Definitely,
yeah.
The two do definitely go together.
Well, Sean, I know you're quite a, like I said, you do like see quite a bit of your gym snaps, Snapchats in the gym and whatnot, but I know you are into your fitness and that, so how do you find it affects your game and how does it help your game as well, the fitter you are?
It makes a big difference, I think. Just over a long match, say especially something like the Worlds, it's either one whole day or it's over 2 days, and
yeah,
it does take it out of you. And having the endurance, having the mental, you know, focus there, as well as obviously you got to feel good, but having the mental concentration, it's so important. It's so important, and like you said, if you look good, you feel good.
Yeah.
But I don't understand why more people haven't started hitting the gym. Not even just like I said, just running, just getting outdoors.
Yeah.
Mm. I think it's just one of those things. It's so hard to kind of get into to begin with.
Yeah.
But once you start doing
it's the first 2 weeks getting into a routine of doing it.
And then it's not a chore.
You actually enjoy it, and you
get all the benefits out of it.
I think
it's the way forward, isn't it?
Made a good point of getting outside.
Yeah.
Because when you're in the club all day,
yeah,
you know, and you're just under them lights and you're popping balls and you're just there and it just gets a bit musty, you know, you just want to just break out and just go, right, just clear your head and just think of nothing.
Yeah.
You know, and it's so nice you can get into a routine. That's where, say, there's so many tournaments now that it's hard to stick to that.
Yeah.
Because you're here, there and everywhere, you know, you're flying about, you're in different time zones. But if you can just plan a little bit more careful and just get that hotel with the gym, or just stick your running trainers in the boot of your car so you can never forget them, you know,
yeah,
and just go for a spin around the block. It does make a hell of a difference, like.
Yeah, good man. Guys, I just want to touch back on something else, back to the tournament, because I forgot to mention it earlier on. With this set up in Preston now, from the 1st of August to the 9th, and these three tournaments all together, how do you guys actually feel about having three qualifiers bunched together now? I mean, because it's a bit like it used to be in the old days. In the old Blackpool days, they used to play three or four tournaments over a space of like 10 days.
Mm-hmm.
And it's sort of like a bit of a strange setup when you're used to having like one set of qualifiers at a time. Like you first, Martin, how do you find three tournaments all at once?
I'm a bit mixed on it. I think three's too many, mm-hmm, personally. Because the thing is, you know, you've got 7 days basically, and then that could determine 2 or 3 months of the season. So I think it's a bit too many, and I think there's gaps in the calendar where actually you could just do it individually. But the upside of it is there's less expenses, really, because you just go there the once and then you play three times, right? So you just, it's an extra couple of nights, so you're not actually doing the travelling to and from. So I think two is enough. If you go there for one, I suppose that's a bit. Unless it's the Worlds or something like that.
Yeah, yeah.
It's a bit pony, but I think three is a lot, I think.
You seem to like Preston anyway, don't
you? I like Preston. Listen, it's the best qualifying venue
I've ever played
in.
I think so, definitely.
Everything should just go there.
Just about 6 hours for us, but other than that.
Well, listen, yeah. I mean, you know, I didn't think there was a lot wrong with Crawley, and he did it for one event.
Tell me about it. Right on our doorstep, and there's one event, you know what I mean?
But, you know. But yeah, it's not too bad. It is what it is. You know what I mean? I'm glad that there is them tournaments to play in, really.
Great.
So I feel lucky that I'm playing in them. So if they put 3, 4, 5, 6 on, whatever, let's play. But personally, I would spread it out a little bit more than that.
Sure.
Yeah, I remember you asked us this question last year, and my opinion's changed a little bit. I did used to think that, you know, more in the one space of time is better, but now I've sort of sided with two at most, three and four and whatever is a bit too much, because like I say, 2 or 3 months worth of the season could be gone if you have a mare for a week.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I think it is results dependent though, isn't it? Do you know what I mean?
Well, exactly. Yeah.
Like you say, because if you don't qualify out of them, then you say you can be a couple of months without a tournament.
Yeah.
If you qualify for all three, you're flying.
Yeah, if you nip your first one, all of a sudden you want to keep playing, you want to have
busy,
as many matches as you can.
Yeah, you're busy, but it's as you say, it's opportunity, innit? They stick on the calendar, we turn up and we play, and that's that.
Opportunity knocks boys.
That's the one.
But I didn't talk about fitness side, sorry.
You didn't actually.
But that's where
as
the fitness side of it comes in.
Fitness as he stuffs a little croissant.
I'll have a chocolate croissant in the door, but yeah, fitness, we talk about boys.
Listen, I didn't eat this morning, they told me they were providing breakfast, so.
Are you enjoying it?
Are you enjoying breakfast, boys?
Good.
Hospitality, very nice.
Good.
Yes.
But,
are you crack on
that's where, that's where the fitness side comes in, because like in Preston, my schedule is I play 7 o'clock on the Wednesday night.
Yeah.
I'm straight back on Thursday in the next tournament. So there's not really much downtime or anything like that.
Yeah.
You just get yourself to bed. And I could have long games, you know. You know I've been prone to long games.
You don't have a long game, either.
And I've drawn, I've got Peter Epton in the first one.
Wow.
I bet we had a quick game now.
You're under it, mate. You are under it.
We're all going to have blisters on our feet after that. But no, it's one of them. And also the fitness side of it helps, I think, when you go tournament to tournament. Because sometimes you come back from China and 2 days later, you're straight into an event over here, right? So I believe the fitter you are, right, you cope with travel so much better.
Yeah.
Jet lag, stuff like that.
Really?
You don't, you're not lethargic. You know, and that's the thing with the, like these guys were saying, once you get into the routine, because it can be tiring the first week, right, when you're not used to exercising, but once you start getting through it, you start being energized. And actually you go out, like Ronnie O'Sullivan a few years ago, when he just started telling people about his running, right? Masters final, right? He's gone and done a 3 mile run in the morning before the Masters, and he's playing best of 19 for 150. And I looked at it and I thought, wow.
You'd be buried 10-1 as well.
Yeah. But I'm thinking, is he not worried about getting tired later on in the evening and that? And he came out and just ran around the table and blitzed everyone. And so you learn that actually it energises you more than makes you lethargic.
Yeah.
Yeah. He's probably just psyched himself up, hasn't he?
But how many players would do that? Would they have a best of night playing in a big final? All right, he's played in loads of big finals, don't get me wrong. Greatest ever, in my opinion.
Yeah, agreed.
And, you know what I mean? How many is going to go and have a 3 mile run before their best of 19s in Sheffield?
No,
for nine bags.
Not about, are they?
Well, I am not.
Normally,
when
he did the max in last round, he went using, was it Newport? He had a race that morning.
Yeah, that's right.
That's what I'm saying.
I'll be in bed till 12:30. trying to enjoy it as much as
you see. That's where, when I've just said to touch on before, where I went to Beijing for the World Unders, for the senior amateur side of the game. Although the ability, you know, the talent wasn't quite there. You could see that a lot of them had potential, but what was there was structure in practice, and structure is in, like, you know, attitude towards gym, fitness, mental approach, and all that is in place. So they've just got the best opportunity now, especially in the Far East, you know, China, Hong Kong, and a few of the Indian lads. There's the World Under 18s. There was a Pakistan lad who won it, and his team, you know, they're all, the morale is just, it's fierce within there. You know, they're always giving them, you know, instructions and structured play. It's when they're practicing and when they're playing, and they've got processes to go through to get them in the best possible mental shape, and they're all hitting the gym, you know, in the hotel, and they're all sort of running around the block, you know, and you can see that part, it is a massive part of the game now, and it's probably because of Ronnie, because he sets standards, you know what I mean, and people always like look up to top players, and whatever they do, they aspire, you know, and so as soon as he started hitting the streets, and like you say, he came out saying, oh, I'm running, I'm doing this, he's probably been doing it for years.
Do you know what I mean?
And a lot of people, I mean, like me back in the day when I was big Bill Werbenyuk, you know what I mean? It's like, I was thinking, oh, this is the life, this. You know, travelling around and, you know, just playing snooker and just not thinking about lifestyle, health, anything like that. But, say, even the Q School experience of this season, you come home and just mentally drained, physically drained. You know, I lost weight when I was over there. You always do at tournaments because, you know, you're drinking water, the stress and the pressures of your playing. Being away from home, your diet goes down the hill because you just, you're sort of warranted by what's around you, you know, yeah. the food outlets, what you can do, and sort of on the road, motorway services, it's not ideal.
Mm.
But you know, we sort of have like a little pack between us that if we can spend a few extra pounds to eat a little bit better,
yeah.
it's the best investment you can ever make.
Yeah.
You know, invest in yourself, in your health, and yeah, hopefully you come back from tournaments.
To be fair, Martin made a great point about that to me last season when we was talking about being away at tournaments and oh, it's hard to eat well, and he said to me, well, not really.
Mm.
It's not, and he's right.
Yeah.
It's easy for us to make that excuse.
Yeah, of course.
We're impressed, and all right, so we'll have McDonald's today, or we'll have KFC tomorrow. And it's easy to do that when he's spot on. If you want to eat properly,
yeah.
you will, no
yeah.
matter where you
yeah,
are.
You can
so
do,
he,
yeah.
He's bang on with that, to be fair.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a mindset, isn't it?
Absolutely, boys.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Well, even if you're going to restaurants, don't go for the burger and chips,
yeah.
go for the Caesar salad.
Yeah, you can do. Never been a salad though.
It's
not.
It's nowhere near the O'Donnell side,
nice
is it?
It wouldn't be as nice as Martin's, probably, but. Yet to try.
Look, guys, it has been awesome catching up with you guys today.
Thanks for having us.
We've covered some great topics, and obviously the world's got to see a bit more about you guys and all. And me and Emma both want to wish you guys all the best for this season.
Yes, definitely.
Thanks
for coming.
And no, thanks for inviting us.
At daffersnooker.com, I want to thank you for your time. We will see you guys very soon.
Cheers.
Take care.
Thanks very much.
Thanks. See ya.